Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Castle Murders by John DeChancie, narrated by Kyle Burrow. And this huge castle, standing here sublime, I love to see the look with which it braves, cased in the unfeeling armor of old time, the lightning, the fierce wind, and trampling waves. Wordsworth. The Eidolons of the King. Preface to the Castle Edition. Ordinarily, an introduction or prolegomenon is expected to shed some light on the material it prefaces or introduces, enough so that the reader may find his way through an unfamiliar literary landscape. In the present case, however, this prefatory note to the work now known as The Eidolons of the King, Tales of Castle Perilous, can serve only to delimit areas of shadow that shroud the work in mystery. Particularly obscure is the question of its origin and authorship. To say that its provenance is mysterious is to put it mildly. To put the matter simply, the original paperbound volumes of the book The Eidolons, cheap pulp paper, hastily glued bindings, garish covers and all, were found one day in the castle library, having been shelved among finely wrought leather-bound tomes of bardic sagas and epic poetry. No one knows who put them there. Would that this were the only mystery. The deeper and more fundamental question, of course, is who wrote these books, and how did their author come by his intimate knowledge of Castle Perilous, to say nothing of his apparent clairvoyance in producing these accounts of the storm of recent events that have raged around it? Castle Perilous. At its very mention, the heart skips a beat. For the benefit of the reader, and especially for those castle guests who seek a general orientation within these pages, it might do well to pause here and describe what the name evokes for we who make the castle our home. For the castle itself is a mystery. Its very existence, maintained from second to second by a transmutational spell laid long ago on a great demon. Castle Perilous is a magical construction. Its huge bulk, far more than what mortal hands could amass, piling stone upon stone, bestrides a citadel commanding the bleak plains of Baranth in the Western Pale. The castle is a world in itself, but far more than that, it contains countless worlds. Some explication is needed. As would any structure of its size, Perilous has innumerable doors and windows, but the anomaly is that some of these are portals to other worlds. Pass through any of the castle's aspects, as they are called, and you cross into a strange new cosmos. There are exactly 144,000 aspects in the castle. Any resident or guest of the castle can describe the sensation of wonder engendered when, after traversing gloomy hallways, one goes through an archway or alcove and steps out onto a vast savanna where herds of animals graze, or into a deep forest limned in cathedral light, or onto a desolate plain whereon sits a domed city under an alien sun. But let us return to the controversy surrounding the authorship of the Eidolons. Who is the man whose name is emblazoned, immodestly so, if I might add, across the covers of these paperbacks? Where does he live? As the language of these works is contemporary, if quasi-grammatical, English with lapses into pseudo-Elizabethan cant, one might well conclude that the author hails from the castle aspect known as Earth. But, truth be told, a thorough search of the appropriate reference volumes has failed to produce any mention of either the author or his work. Moreover, no trace can be found of the publisher whose name and address is printed on the verso of the title page. There are attendant minor mysteries, of which we should make passing mention. The author's surname, for instance, What nationality is it? English via Anglo-Norman? French? Anglicized Italian? The name is very possibly a pseudonym. And who are the individuals whose fawning endorsements are brooded on and about the cover? Presumably approving critics or admiring colleagues of the author, and we would be forced to conclude one or the other or both, were it not for the fact that no trace can be found of these people either. Phantoms all. Then there is the matter of the cover art. What sort of deranged soul could... But let us set these relatively trivial matters aside. What, then, are we to make of this? The only conjecture to acquire any currency is that the Eidolons originated in a world that is a variant of Earth, and one in which the castle is a fiction, not the reality we know. Here we tread disputed ground, for some hold that there are more than 144,000 universes. In fact, there may be an infinite number of them, of which the assortment provided by the castle is only a random and constantly shifting sample. Be that as it may, the conjecture that these books were generated in some backwater universe does not explain how they came to the castle, nor how they were written. Indeed, it makes the issue all the more obscure, for how could a stranger to the castle, a stranger even to the universe in which the castle exists, have produced these highly romanticized but essentially accurate accounts, even to describing the intimate thoughts and sometimes inexplicable actions of the master of Castle Perilous, Incarnadine, king by the grace of the gods and lord of the Western Pale? We can dismiss out of hand the notion that His Majesty penned the Eidolons, for he has categorically denied it. Who, then? A guest? If so, why the secrecy? What is he, or she, hiding? I have no answers to these questions, but as royal librarian, I can here offer a somewhat different explanation for the origin of the Eidolons. The castle's library is an enigma in itself. Not a day goes by when the library staff is not surprised by finding some new wonder on its shelves, books that were not even suspected to exist. Marvelous books, strange books, even dangerous books. One such describes the construction of a weapon so terrible that I cannot bring myself to describe its intended effects. Another provides schematics for an infernal device which, from what can be made of it, is intended for the express purpose of trapping a god. Which deity is to be bagged is not specified. Needless to say, these and other dismaying oddities have been sequestered in the closed stacks, where, if I have anything to say in the matter, they will remain indefinitely. Where do these books come from? Not even Lord Incarnadine can say. He himself has added very few books to the collection. Thus, I am not beyond imagining that the library itself has magically generated the Eidolons. How? I know not. Why has it chosen to do so in such a peculiar idiom? I cannot fathom it. But the works exist, and that is enough for me. Their significance and importance cannot be questioned. You hold in your hand a new edition of the Eidolons, painstakingly set in movable type from the originals, printed on vellum stock, and bound in fine-grained leather with gilt lettering and filigree. The text is faithfully reproduced without editorial emendation or gloss. Read the Eidolons and wonder, taking with a grain of salt its melodramatic excesses. Written in an uneven style, by turns breezy, serviceable, and sesquipedalian, these tales hew close to all the conventions of the popular romance, and are consequently guilty of the faults and foibles that go along with such fare. But minor narrative flaws can be ignored, as can the occasional textual solecism. In the first volume, portfolio is used where folio is meant, a typo or the result of the author's ignorance. We will charitably opt for the former, as Folio does appear elsewhere. It is the story, after all, that is of prime interest. Above all, read the castle tales and enjoy them. The magic casements open. The perilous seas and all of creation lie before you. Osmeric, Royal Scribe and Librarian. Forward to the fifth volume. Enigma upon enigma. Initially, only 4 volumes of the Castle edition of the Eidolons were planned, for the simple reason that only 4 original paperbacks were found. Now, a 5th penny dreadful. Really, how long are these cheap books expected to last? Surely no more than a fortnight. Has appeared in its rightful place on the shelf next to its kin. Curiously, the preface to the first edition was reproduced in this new volume, thereby giving new life to the inside job theory of authorship. You may well imagine my chagrin at finding myself quoted on the back cover. Read the Castle Tales and enjoy. Indeed. But what is absolutely mystifying, there are no words to express the emotion, is that this very foreword appeared as well, paradoxically so, for I had not even begun to write it. Yet here it is, written in an uncanny imitation of my own style, complete with expressions of my astonishment at finding it. I will not begin an attempt at explanation. The librarian proposes, the library disposes. Read on. Osmeric, Royal Scribe and Librarian. Abelard, South Dakota. It was a stark and dormy night. The campus was quiet. Northeastern State University wasn't the liveliest of schools, and it was a Monday night, and it was snowing again. The wind howling out of the plains. Nothing to do but stay in the dorm and study. There was enough on Melanie McDaniel's study agenda. Deadlines were approaching. A paper for Philosophy 101 on Aristotle's ethics was due in 3 days, and one on Conrad's Nostromo for English 125, 20th century British novels, had been due 3 days ago. There was a calculus test tomorrow. Other stuff. But Melanie didn't feel much like studying. She didn't feel much like doing anything but fiddling on her computer. Fiddling was what it was. Melanie was online via modem to the campus's computer bulletin board system, or BBS. Through it, she was plugged into a worldwide network of amateur computer users called the CyberNet. The net was a forum. A meeting place, for people who liked to gab about anything and everything. The discussions were grouped into topic areas, with subjects ranging from current events to Star Trek to computer software. Melanie posted messages in many areas, but she particularly liked Woman Talk, the National Women's Forum, a cross between a slumber party and a backroom political caucus. The cathode ray tube of Melanie's IBM clone displayed to Melanie McDaniel from Cindy Thayer, message 256, subject, men again. I second the emotion. Men are congenitally polygamous, as in higamous pigamous. When we're that way, we're sluts. You can't win, kid. Sorry you lost him. But there are a lot of fish in the sea, except that they're all kind of slimy and scaly. Keep your chin up. Bye. Cindy. Origin, the boarding house, Cooperstown, NY, 1-398/276.9. She looked out the window. Icy snowflakes ticked against the glass. Abelard was completely blotted out. Nothing was visible except an outside light in the quadrangle, a yellow halo in the darkness. She thought about Chad and about how the last thing he had said to her was that he needed space and that the relationship wasn't going anywhere and that he needed to be free of commitments in order to concentrate on getting through a tough term on his way to his economics degree. Maybe when he was through grad school and his MBA, he'd be ready for a serious relationship. Yeah? So then what was he doing now, impaled as he was on the claws of Nadine Borkowski? She was into him deep. He'd even cut his hair and sold his BMW motorcycle. She wasn't about to ride on the back of that thing. So what did he need it for? Yes, Nadine. Anything you say, Nadine. Chad wasn't polygamous. He was just dumb. Dumb to fall for that domineering, scheming, lowborn, vile, deceitful. She took a deep breath. So what? She'd lost him, and that was that. Did she still love him? Of course. He was terrifically good-looking and a lot of fun. But someone else had snared him, and Melanie was history. Life goes on. Yes, she was still in love with him. Melanie typed at the keyboard, telling the BBS to search for messages with the name McDaniel in the 2 line. A pair popped up, and she keyed in the digits for the first one. To Melanie McDaniel, from Fran DeMiro. Subject, abortion. The fundamentalists aren't going to change tactics now. Sure, some recent court decisions have been going their way, but... Melanie squelched the message. Another go-around on the abortion issue. She wasn't in the mood for serious discussion right now. Besides, she didn't know how she felt about the issue anymore. For years, she had harbored the suspicion, unspoken and even unrealized until very recently, that if she were indeed ever faced with the decision of whether to have an abortion, she wouldn't be able to go through with it. Not because of moral qualms, but general queasiness. Well, now she was faced with it. She was almost sure she was pregnant with Chad's baby. You don't miss 2 periods and put it down to the whims of nature. Not if you knew your diaphragm had slipped off on at least 1 occasion. There was an outside chance that the missed periods were due to something else, but... an abortion? She just didn't think she could go through with it. Funny how you could intellectually believe in a thing and not be able to accept it emotionally. Without logging off the system, she left the desk and lay down on the bed to cry quietly for a while. When she was done, she got up and sat back down at the computer. She hoped the blues weren't returning. Her depression. She had suffered with it off and on since her early teens, and had once been prescribed medication for it. Now, what with Chad and the pregnancy, a bad bout of the blues was a danger. Drying her eyes, she punched in the other message number. To Melanie McDaniel, from Linda Barclay, message 287, subject, boyfriends. Melanie smiled. She liked Linda, and had been exchanging messages with her for several months over the private channel of the system. Linda knew everything about Chad, and about Chad straying off to Nadine. Melanie had been very open, spilling everything but the pregnancy. That was still top secret. The body of Linda's message read, "You sounded pretty down in your last post. Did something new happen? I mean, something bad new? If so, tell me about it. Don't stew. I know you've heard it all before, but it isn't the end of the world when your boyfriend dumps you. Life goes on. Doesn't help, does it? Okay, but talk about it. It might stop hurting just a little bit. Post back soon. See ya." Origin, the Castle BBS. 1-897/675. Melanie gave the computer instructions to boot up the wherewithal to post a message. The process was the computerized equivalent of writing a note on a piece of paper and thumbtacking it to a cork bulletin board. Except that it was done with electrons, not paper and metal and cork. To Linda Barclay, from Melanie McDaniel. Subject, life. "You're right. I'm not feeling very good. It's like what's outside tonight. Just snow swirling around and darkness and loneliness. Sometimes I think I just want everything to go dark forever, and no more Melanie. I guess I'm in a pretty bad way. Hell, damn. Know any good four-letter words? You can't say the F-word on the net, or the moderator will come around and WJS. Her eyes filled with tears and she was blinded. By the time she dabbed her face dry with a tissue, she saw that she had inadvertently hit Control S. The message had been saved and posted on the system. Well, she'd just kill it and start all over again. But then she shrugged. What the hell? Leave it. She didn't feel like BBSing anymore tonight. She was about to log off when she noticed something blinking in the upper left corner of the screen. It was a prompt, and it read, "Press R to read incoming message." She'd never seen anything like it before. Was the system operator trying to talk to her online? She hit R, and the message spilled across the screen at 2400 bits per second. To Melanie McDaniel. From Linda Barclay. Private message. Subject: worried. No, you don't sound at all good. Something did happen. Tell me about it. Post back immediately. I can talk to you online. Please answer. Linda. Origin: the Castle BBS. Melanie was puzzled. All this time, she had assumed Linda was posting from a BBS far away in another city. It took days, sometimes weeks, for a message on the cybernet to negotiate the maze of interconnecting phone lines and reach its intended recipient, and the same length of time for an answer to get back. The net was not a direct communication system. That would cost a lot of money, and the net was a non-profit system. A bulletin board didn't work like that. It was slow. However, it was cheap. But Linda was answering a message that Melanie had just posted minutes ago. That was impossible if Melanie understood the way the net operated. The only way it could happen was if Linda was sitting at the terminal of the university's BBS computer over in the student union, just a block away. But the message's origin line had read, "The Castle BBS, not the Eagle's Eyrie, the name of the university system." Melanie had never noticed a location tag for the castle, but it had to be outside the university. At the select prompt, she hit R for reply, and 2, Linda Barclay, came up automatically. For subject, she hit the return key, and the computer reproduced Linda's subject line, worried. She began typing the body of the message. "I was surprised to get your message. Are you somehow patched through the Eagle's Eyrie? How did you get my message so quickly? Anyway, I'm sorry about the last post. Was feeling pretty rocky. But I'm okay." Suddenly, the keyboard froze. She vainly jabbed random keys and hit return, but nothing happened. Then, "Chat. Start. Hi, Melanie. Thought I'd break in and talk online. Your message did worry me. How are you really feeling?" On the screen, the cursor had moved to a blank line. Melanie was puzzled. She typed, "Linda, is that you?" "Yeah, it's me. Wanna tell me what's going on inside your head?" "How are you doing this? Are you on the university system?" "No, but I'm using a modem you wouldn't believe. It can do almost anything. I'm on a direct line to your computer." "Wow, that really neat. I can't understand it, but it's great. Anyway, you're right. I'm pretty down, but I'll be all right." "Excuse me if I don't believe that. You're really sound depressed. You're not thinking of doing something silly, are you?" Melanie thought about it. She was indeed thinking of doing something. But what she typed was, "No, I'll be all right. Excuse my typing." "You're putting up a good front, but aren't you having suicidal thoughts?" Melanie sighed. No use to hide it. "Okay, you're right. How did you know?" "How? Because I've been there myself. But I sense something else wrong. Something major. Care to tell me?" Well, there is something. Geez, I don't know. Are you pregnant? Melanie was amazed. Linda, do you have a crystal ball? Yeah, you guessed it. I'm preggy. That's crystal. I don't need one to know who the daddy is, do I? The dork. Chad's not a dork. He's immature and needs someone to tell him what to do and be a mother to him. I wasn't ready to do that. Sorry. Have you told him? No. Why complicate his life? It was my fault anyway. It takes two to tango, kid. Well, have you thought about what you're going to do about it? If you're talking about abortion, I think I've pretty much ruled that out. So you either keep the baby or give it up. I haven't even begun to think about that. I guess I'll have to drop out of school. Not necessarily, but you might want to do that just to get yourself together. Yeah, I'm so behind. I haven't done a thing all term. I might flunk out. Ever thought about getting away for a while? Away from everything? Just to clear your head? I'd love to be somewhere else. Anywhere else. The Virgin Islands, maybe. Ha! Great place for a woman in my condition. Sun, sand, blue water. I'd love it. Well, I can't give you the Virgin Islands exactly, but you're welcome to come stay with us at the castle. What's the castle? It's just what it sounds like. I live with a lot of people in a huge castle. It's fun. We'd love to have you. Where is it? Very near to you. In fact, you wouldn't believe how close it is. Want to hop over for a visit? Sounds inviting. Maybe I'll take you up on it someday. Why not now? We can come pick you up. Melanie thought it over. What the heck? What else was she doing that was so important? Tonight? Well, okay. Yeah, if it's not too much trouble. Want me to wait outside the dorm? I'm in Haberman Hall. Are you going to send a car? Hey, you guys aren't terrorists or anything, are you? Yeah, we hijack castles. We have a fix on you right now. You don't have to do anything. Just a sec. The cursor blinked at her silently. She sat and waited for a half minute, then keyed, Linda, are you still there? Yep. Melanie, go to your closet and open the door. Melanie frowned. Huh? Just go look in your closet. You'll be surprised. Well, if you say so. This is really... Melanie didn't know what to say. She got up and went to the closet of the small dorm room and put her hand on the doorknob. Was this some practical joke? Some jape designed to make her feel foolish? If so, it wasn't very funny, and it didn't seem like a Linda thing to do. But what else could it be? She turned the knob and opened the door. The closet was full of her roommate's junk, just as before. No change. So it was a joke after all. Melanie didn't understand. Then she saw light coming from the rear of the closet and suddenly noticed that it looked as if the back wall had been torn out. Light was coming through from what she presumed was the room next door. Melanie? It was a woman's voice, and one she didn't recognize.
Who is it?
It's me, Linda. Can we clear some of this junk out of the way? Melanie shoved aside her roommate's four winter coats, one of which was fox fur and very expensive, and revealed a smiling face.
Hi, Melanie. I'm Linda.
Linda was pretty and blonde and had large blue eyes. Her teeth were very white and even.
Hi, Melanie said. You were right next door all the time?
Not exactly. Is all this stuff yours?
No. My roommate ran off to Peru with a guy, an archaeologist. She left all her stuff.
So you have the place to yourself, huh? Great. Want to come through?
Okay.
Melanie shoved the tangle of clothes to one side and made an opening for herself, which she slipped through, ducking under the low shelf. She stumbled on a guitar case, and Linda helped her out the other side.
What was on the other side was not another dorm room. It was an immense chamber with a vaulted ceiling, filled with strange and wondrous things. The place looked like something out of a Frankenstein movie. Melanie's gaze was torn between the huge machines resembling electrical transformers along the far wall, and an arrangement of even stranger components in the middle of the floor. "That's the computer I've been working with," Linda said, pointing to the latter grouping. "It's a mainframe."
"A mainframe?"
"Yeah, but it's different from your average computer. Works by magic."
"Magic?"
"Yeah. Come over and meet Jeremy. He's our computer whiz." Linda led Melanie across the floor and around a U-shaped wall of instruments. Seated at a terminal in the middle was a thin young man in blue tights and a red tunic. He looked no more than 16 years old. Jeremy looked over his shoulder. "You want to hold the portal or can we let it float?" Linda turned to Melanie. "Are you going to stay with us for a while? We can call back the portal any time."
Sure. Yeah, I'll stay."
"Break the spell, Jeremy."
"Sure thing."
Jeremy jabbed at the keyboard, looked at the screen, then sat back and swiveled around.
"It's broken."
Melanie looked back at the wall. The opening was gone, replaced by dark stone. She turned back to Linda, who she now noticed was dressed in black tights, pointed shoes, and an orange and white striped doublet. She looked like she was dressed to play Hamlet.
"Linda, where are we?"
Linda smiled brightly. "Welcome to Castle Perilous." Castle. Queen's Dining Hall. The discussion had somehow gotten sidetracked onto music, having started out on the question of whether new inductees would benefit by a proposed formal orientation session. The upshot was no, and that had been the end of the matter.
"Myself, I like classical,"
said the man everyone called Monsieur DeChancie, as he picked at a plate of clams in Mornay sauce. He was small and round-faced and wore old-fashioned round glasses. He was always dressed for the opera, white tie and tails. He was sociable, but no one knew much about him because he rarely spoke of himself.
"So do I," Dino Williams said.
DeChancie was mildly surprised.
"You do?"
"Yeah. What's the matter? Don't you think my kind can like that stuff?"
"It's not that. You've never said anything before."
"Well, I do. Oh, I like the kind you can dance to all right, but I think classical's good too."
"Who's your favorite composer?"
"I listen to it, but I don't know much about it. I kind of liked that thing you were playing when I came to get you for lunch."
"That was Peer Gynt Suite by Edvard Grieg."
"Grieg, huh?" The dining hall was full. The Earth portal had been wandering lately, and there were many new people from all over the world. Consequently, the table bore dishes representing many different kinds of cuisines. Tall, curly-haired Jean Ferraro was sampling something he thought might be Bolognese, rice, nuts, and vegetables in a ginger sauce. He chewed thoughtfully. Malaysian? Anyway, it wasn't bad, if you liked that sort of stuff. He swallowed. "Edvard Grieg," he said, "was as fat as a pig." Dina Williams looked at him. "You say something?" A man called Thaxton, light-haired and distinguished, was seated to Jean's right.
"He certainly did. He said that Edvard Grieg was as fat as a pig."
"I heard him."
"Pig? What the hell's that?"
Thin, balding and middle-aged, Cleve Dalton was on Jean's left.
"There's a term for that sort of rhyme, but it escapes me."
"It's called cheating," Thaxton said.
"What brought on that bit of verse, Jean?" Dalton asked.
"Nothing. It just suddenly occurred to me that Edvard Grieg was..."
"Etc., etc.,"
Thaxton said.
"Well, go on, man. Finish it."
"Finish what?"
The Clarihue.
Dina looked offended. Clara what? Thaxton said,
At Balliol, we used to improvise them at table. Bali, what? Oxford.
A man in Nigerian tribal dress seated next to Dina said,
We used to do limericks at Trinity.
Thaxton said,
I shouldn't be surprised at anything they do in Cambridge.
He turned to Jean.
Well?
Jean regarded the stone-ribbed ceiling for a moment. Then, stumped, he took another bite.
You don't start a Clarihue without finishing it.
Oh, I do it all the time, Dalton said. Music? Let's see. Okay. How about this? Gustav Moller liked to jump and holler.
Thaxton frowned.
It's all very well to start something. Well, I suppose I'll have to do your dirty work.
He took another bite of steak Diane and chewed thoughtfully.
Right, I've got it.
He got up and recited.
Gustav Moller liked to jump and holler. He wrote to perfection the tune Resurrection.
Dalton scowled.
Not what you'd call inspired.
Thaxton sat down.
You can do better, I suppose.
Maybe.
Many of the diners were in costume. Not all were medieval, some shading into the Renaissance and beyond. Jean was dressed in something out of Dumas or Edmond Rostand. On the table in front of him, a wide-brimmed hat blossomed with a white plume. He had taken to training with a rapier lately and had become quite the proficient fencer. He was good with almost any kind of sword. He was, in fact, the castle's best blade wielder, dazzling swordsmanship being his particular magical stock in trade. Suddenly, goosed by the muse, he sat up straight. He blurted, Edvard Grieg was as fat as a pig. He wrote Peer Gynt, I sure wish he didn't. Groans around the table. Dalton picked up the plate with a roast chicken on it and sat it in front of Jean.
For that, you win the Pulitzer Prize.
Thaxton said,
For that, you ought to be taken out and shot.
One bullet through the head, please. Quick and clean. Except for a little blood and brains on the ground.
Very little brains, I'm afraid.
Hey, I'm eaten,
Dina complained. DeChancie said,
What are you up to these days, Jean? You're dressed fit to kill, and something tells me that should be taken literally.
Snowclaw and I are staging a revolution in Arcadia.
I don't believe I know the aspect.
Keep, West Wing, right next to the chapel.
You, Manuel?
Yeah.
What do they make of Snowclaw?
Sheila tricks him out to look human. She's good at that. Thaxton said,
I've never understood why that beast doesn't hang about with his own kind.
I don't recall ever seeing Snowclaw's kind in the castle,
DeChancie said.
Well, with the other non-humans, then.
Jean said,
Snowy's always said that he basically likes the way humans smell. Reminds him of rotting blubber.
He happens to like rotting blubber.
Where do the non-humans hang out?
Dina wanted to know.
They have their own dining hall, DeChancie said. Haven't you ever been there?
No. Where is it?
North Four Building, near the Hall of Kings.
The Hall of the Mountain Kings, perhaps,
Thaxton said slyly. DeChancie ignored him.
There are many other dining halls and guest residences, you know.
Dina said,
That I know. I ran into one the other day. All kinds of people in there I didn't recognize.
They would be guests from human worlds other than Earth.
I kind of figured that.
They tend to keep to themselves. So do the non-humans.
As do we, Dalton said.
Nerds of a feather, Jean mumbled.
Speak of the non-human, Dalton said.
Everyone looked up as Snowclaw came striding into the room with his huge broadaxe, blade wickedly gleaming,
balanced across his shoulder. Snowclaw was an immense, ursine human-like creature, completely covered in fur of the purest Arctic white. Yellow-eyed and sinewy, mouth ferociously toothed, Snowclaw was something you would not care to be politely introduced to in a clean, well-lighted place, much less meet in a dark alley.
"Hi, everybody."
He came over to the table and threw the broadaxe down, knocking over a tureen of crab bisque.
"Oops, sorry."
"Think nothing of it," Thaxton said, mopping his lap with a serviette.
"Your spell wore off," Jean observed. "We'll have to stop by Sheila's world and get you fixed up."
"Sir, Jean," Dalton said, "you and Snowclaw are off to war and revolution. Who are you overthrowing? What sort of potentate? King? Prince? Sultan? Pharaoh? What?"
"I'm embarrassed to say that we're aiding the royalists against an anarcho-syndicalist regime that came to power by revolution. The regime's been so monstrous and bloody that it makes a monarchy look utopian by comparison."
"I'm surprised there are any royalists left."
"There are almost none in the country itself. Most of them are emigres in a neighboring state."
"Well, it sounds like a good cause."
"It does kind of recharge the old moral batteries," Jean acknowledged.
"How do you feel about it, Snowclaw?"
Snowclaw sat down.
"Don't know about that stuff. I just like it when the fur flies and the guts go splattering all over the place."
"Energizing the ethical dry cells, as it were," Thaxton said.
Just then, Linda Barclay walked in with Melanie in tow, Jeremy bringing up the rear. Introductions were made all around. Dina asked,
"How do you like it so far, Melanie?"
"Fine, so far."
"Wait till the creepy stuff starts happening."
Like what?"
Dina set her coffee cup down.
"Well, let's see. A while back, we had the blue meanies invading. Then the devils from hell. But that's nothing compared to when the whole place goes crazy and the walls turn to rubber and things start shaking and shifting around."
Dalton said, "The castle has been unstable at times. There are permanent areas of instability, but you keep away from those parts."
"Oh."
"Soon you'll acquire a sixth sense about the place, and you'll be able to find your way around. And depending on what your magical talent is, you'll be able to use that to advantage as well."
"Magical talent?"
Linda explained, "Most people acquire the ability to do magic when they get to the castle."
"Most people," Jean said. "Then there are the retards like Snowy and me."
"Don't listen to him. Jean's the best swordsman in the castle, and Snowy can teleport."
"Not very well,"
Snowclaw said.
"Last time I tried it, I slammed myself into a wall and got knocked out for an hour."
"You never mentioned it," Jean said. "That's strange."
"It hurt."
"Do you have to run to start teleporting?"
"No, I usually stay still and just think. Then I take like one or two steps and I'm where I want to go."
"Then how did you wind up slamming into a wall?"
"You tell me."
Jean thought about it. "You must have materialized inside the wall." Linda flinched.
"Oh my, that's a terrible thought. Don't do it again, Snowy."
"I won't. I never liked doing it."
Dalton looked at Melanie.
"Most people's talents don't get them into trouble if they exercise a little discretion and watch what they're doing."
Melanie nodded.
"I see. What will my talent be?"
"Oh, there's no telling. Anything from materialization to teleportation to dowsing," Jean said.
"Necromancy, palm reading."
"Not that stuff," Linda jeered.
"Channeling?"
"It'll be something useful, Melanie."
"Channeling is useful," Jean said.
"Right.
I happen to channel a 30,000-year-old high priest of Lemuria."
"You do?"
Melanie said, a trifle awed.
"Sure.
On the astral plane, he's thought of as a very wise being. Dalton asked, "So, what's the name of this wise and astral being?" "Well, if you're just going to scoff," Jean said. "Sorry, I'm asking nicely now. Who is he?" "No, your skeptical vibes are queering my karma."
"Oh, come on," Dalton mock pleaded.
"Only if you're sincere."
"I'm sincere. What's the name of the entity you channel?"
"Murray."
"Murray?"
"But he likes to be called Skip." Melanie turned to Linda. "They're kidding, right?" "They're always kidding. Pay no attention to them. It's going to be a while before I get used to all this," Melanie said.
"You will," Dalton assured her.
"After lunch," Linda said, "I'll give you the cook's tour." "Is it lunchtime?" Melanie asked. "Well, it's after 9 p.m. Eastern, so maybe you're not hungry." "I didn't eat dinner because I didn't have any appetite, but I'm kind of hungry now." "Try this cheese plate," Thaxton suggested. "The camembert is the real thing, and these truffles are authentic, if I'm any judge." "I like this curried lobster," Dina said. "You like curry?"
"Quiche?" Dalton said,
proffering a dish past Jean's nose.
"Get that wimp food out of my face," Jean said.
"A thousand pardons."
"We dashing, non-quiche eating types stick to meat and potatoes." Jean pointed to Snowclaw. "He, on the other hand, likes beeswax candles dipped in Thousand Island dressing. But as they say, de gustibus non disputandem est, cha-cha-cha."
"I like paraffin candles sometimes," Snowclaw said. "It depends on my mood."
Jean noticed that Melanie's green eyes had gone apprehensive. "I'm sorry, didn't we introduce Snowclaw?" "No," Melanie said in a small voice. "Melanie, I want you to meet Snowclaw, a friend of ours."
"Hi, Melanie," Snowclaw said.
I'm
not as scary as I look, Melanie."
"Very nice to meet you, Snowclaw."
"Same here. Reason I said that was that I noticed you weren't looking at me."
"I was a little scared. I'm sorry."
"It's okay."
"He's a pussycat," Jean assured her. "Really, tell her about your hobbies, Snowy."
"My hobbies?"
"Yeah, needlepoint, cloisonné, batiking, a real dweeb."
"What the heck is batiking?"
Melanie giggled nervously. "And a rabid birder," Jean went on. "You can see him every morning out in the fend, field glass in hand, lusting for a glimpse of a chaffinch or a chevroned waxwing or even a partridge, a quail perhaps, nesting in the tall gorse." Linda rolled her eyes. "Jean, really?"
"Sometimes I don't understand a word he's saying,"
Snowclaw said, shaking his furry head. "Jean is our resident wit, capital W," Linda explained.
"I'd append the prefix nit," Dalton said.
"Resident twit,"
Thaxton suggested. Thank you," Jean said, rising. With a sweeping gesture, he put on his plumed hat. "And I'd love to continue this pleasant badinage, but we have a revolution to run." Left hand on the hilt of his sword, he turned to Snowclaw. "Garçon?"
"Are you talking to me?"
Snowclaw said.
"Allons enfants de la patrie."
"Wrong period for the costume,"
Dalton said. Monsieur Duquesne sang,
"Le jour des gloires arrivé."
"Let's go, D'Artagnan," Jean said, slapping Snowclaw's shoulder in passing. Snowclaw was still shaking his head.
"I don't know."
He got up and shouldered his axe.
"Nice to meet you, Melanie. See you around."
"Bye." The two adventurers left the hall. "They're interesting," Melanie said.
Oh,
decidedly so, Thaxton agreed. They're always up to something. I, on the other hand...
You're as boring as I am, Dalton said. Let's go play some golf.
Oh, God, Thaxton said, with a hopeless look ceiling word. Golf, Melanie said. There's a course outside?
There's a course inside, Dalton corrected. There's not much outside but a 400-foot drop to a desert.
Thaxton threw down his serviette. Well, if I must, I must. Linda said, Mr. Thaxton, if you hate golf, why do you always give in and play? For the simple reason that I have nothing else better to do. But the castle has no end of worlds.
He gave her a wan smile.
Yes, but you see, my dear, I'd be in them.
Linda nodded glumly. I think I know what you mean.
Dalton thumped Thaxton on the back.
Buck up, old man.
Oh, I don't want to give the impression that I'm unhappy in Castle Perilous. I think it's a perfectly marvelous place here.
Then let's get out on the links.
Right you are. Very nice to have met you, Melanie.
Same here. Have a good game.
Well, we shall certainly try.
All this time, Jeremy had been stuffing himself in silence. When the two golfers left, he leaned back and delivered a tremendous belch.
Excuse me?
That was really ignorant, Dina said.
I said excuse me.
Linda looked down at Melanie's tattered jeans.
Do you want me to whip up an outfit for you, or do you want to keep wearing those clothes?
Melanie tugged at her sweatshirt, from which the lettering Northeastern State had faded.
These? Everybody else is wearing fancy stuff. Maybe I should too.
Do you want a dress, a gown, or pants?
Pants.
I think you'd look good in shorts over tights.
What color tights?
Black? You have green eyes. What if I go for a match?
Okay.
Fine. Stand up.
Melanie stood.
What for?
Linda waved her right hand.
How's that?
Melanie looked down at herself. Gone were the sweatshirt, jeans, and white athletic shoes turned gray with grime. Instead, she was attired in forest green tights, brown leather short pants, matching boots, and a thonged jerkin over a green puffed-sleeved blouse. Her old clothes and shoes lay in a pile at her feet.
How did you do that?
Magic. What do you think?
I look like Robin Hood.
Yeah, I... What's the matter?
With a sudden look of despair, Melanie slumped to her seat.
I was just thinking, I have a calculus test tomorrow. We can always send you right back.
You can?
Melanie thought about it. She shook her head emphatically.
I don't want to go back. But what will people say about my just vanishing? And my parents?
Linda said, It used to be that there was no way back from the castle, and people wound up as missing persons or listed as possible murder victims. But Lord Incarnadine re-established the Earth Portal, and now we have almost complete control of it. What we can do now is set up some kind of cover story to explain your absence.
What would I tell my parents?
That you're dropping out of school for a while and staying with friends, which would only be the truth. You could keep in touch with them by letter or phone.
You can phone from the castle?
With the castle's mainframe, we can tap into any communication system in the world.
You can even fax a letter, Jeremy said.
Really?
Melanie let out a breath.
I guess I don't have any excuse not to stay.
No, you don't.
Why don't you have a bite, and then we'll introduce you to Lord Incarnadine. Jeremy, have you seen him lately?
Last time I saw him, he said something about going to his sister's garden party.
Princess Dorcas? Oh, that's right. Well, that's one party we can't crash. Maybe later. Go ahead and eat, Melanie.
Melanie pulled up the cheese plate and bit into a wedge of camembert. She was hungry, and everything looked so appetizing. Don't feel guilty about stuffing yourself, she thought. After all, you're eating for... She froze.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.